All right, so in this lecture, let us understand Appium architecture and see how this tool works in the backend. Okay, so I'm going to explain the whole architecture with this diagram. First, Appium client code. So this is where you actually write your code. Okay, so you know that if you want to automate any mobile app, you should start writing some automation code in your favorite language. In the last lecture, we have seen that Appium can be written in multiple languages like Java, C Sharp, Python, Ruby. Okay, so it's up to you in what language you write. Basically, the language what we choose, we say it as a client code, because we are the clients here and Appium need to serve us. So in this whole concept, clients are nothing but we. Client code is nothing but the code what you write to automate your mobile apps. Okay, so we will choose one editor, which is obviously Eclipse, in our next lectures, and we write our code. This course is completely taught on Java, right? So we write a code in Java language for Appium. Thereafter, there is a server for Appium which you need to download. So all the download installations you will see from very next lecture. You don't worry about it. So just understand how the concept works here. Okay, so once you have written the code, at the same time you need to download and start the Appium server in your local. So when you start the server, your server will start at some port called 4723 or any port whatever you are interested in your local. So when you start this server will keep on listening to your client code. Okay, it will wait and will listen to receive your client code. And in your client code, you will clearly tell that redirect my code to this port, because at this port Appium server is sitting and it's listening. Okay, so why we are redirecting to Appium server? Because this server have a capability of interpreting your code and then understand what all you need to perform and perform all these actions on your mobile device. All that responsibilities is taken care by this Appium server. So that's the reason we have to send our code to the Appium server. So we will download the server, start the server at one specific port number, and we write our code, and at the end we redirect our code to this port. Okay, all these are simple steps. Don't worry that should I write complicated code to redirect everything, all this. These are just simple one line code which will does all this work. Okay, so that's how you send your code to your server. And when you send your code, Appium wraps your code into one JSON format and send it to the server, because the server expects JSON as an input. Okay, so that's the reason, no matter in which language you write, you may write it in Java, you may write it in Python, JavaScript, write it in any language. At the end, when you run your test, the first job what Appium does is to convert your code into JSON. So obviously, whatever language you write, as it is converting it into JSON, which server needs. So server has the capability of interpreting that JSON file and understand what are the actions we need to do on the mobile, and then it redirects those actions and execute those on the mobile devices. Once it gets a response, again it travels in the same direction to back, give the response to Appium server, and Appium server sends back to the Appium client code in the JSON format again. And this Java client code whatever you write have an ability to parse the response JSON and give the output to the user. Okay, the same direction how it travels, the same direction it gets back the response as well. Okay, now Once it receives the command from here, and it will understand first in whatever mobile I have to perform these actions, because all this we will give it here. Okay, perform this action on the Android, on this specific app, on this specific screen, in this specific edit box, all those details we will have here, right? So Appium server will interpret all those actions and it will decide to which mobile I have to route this by reading your JSON file, whatever you sent. If it is Android, then under hood it uses UiAutomator to test framework to talk to Android. What is this framework? UiAutomator 2 is provided by the Android guys. Okay, Android team itself have created this testing framework to test their APIs. Similarly, iOS also have created one framework called XUI test to test their iOS apps. So our tool uses their testing frameworks under hood to perform automation on their platforms. Okay, so in general, without using their test frameworks, it's little tricky to automate on mobile devices. So but if you use under hood their specific test frameworks designed particularly by those platforms as under hood, then you will have robust results, because you know that these provide a super compatibility and consistency in automating, because those guys itself have released their testing frameworks. So Appium uses this at under hood and performs automation. If it is Android, it uses their framework called UiAutomator 2 as their testing framework. If it is iOS, it uses their testing framework called XUI test and perform automation on iOS apps. It decides by reading the JSON, whatever the user sent from their Java client code, and then route the request to appropriate device. Okay, so this is how the Appium architecture works in the backend. So now to run our Appium test cases, now we need an editor to write the code and client jars as well. Okay, so when I say that I will write my Appium code in Java, you have to also download supporting Java client libraries of Appium, right? So then only that jar will support your code. So in the next lecture you will see what are those Java client libraries and how to download them, and then you should also download one Appium server. So that this is the heart of the architecture. You have, without the server, if you simply write the code and run, it routes to nowhere and your test fails. So you also know that you also need Appium server, Java client jars, and to execute on devices, you either need a real device or virtual device. Okay, you can also create virtual device in your system and execute your tests on that virtual mobile device. Okay, you will also see that in your coming section. So now you are clear on what all you need before you start your first test case, so that in the next section, when I start downloading all the servers, virtual device and the Java client, you will not be confused like, why do I need all this? As you know how this architecture works now, you will be clear whenever I am showing the instructions to download all these tools to make our first test run. Alright, so that's all I have in this lecture, and that's about architecture. We'll see you in the next section with installation instructions for all this. Okay, thank you.